So he wanted to go into medicine. But this drum thing just wouldn't leave him alone. It wouldn't leave him alone. And so Maurice White life, when I talk about his story, is really amazing because his story is a lot about being in the right place at the right time and alignment. It's not about hustle. I know a lot of people talk about how people hustle and grind. It's really about him being where he needs to be and being aligned to where. Walking down the street and just walking happenstance on something and things of that nature. And so that's how it happened here. Working at the hospital, he meets Louis Satterfield, which at the time was a great bass player. And they end up collaborating, end up getting a drum set for his house and jamming and everything else. And this, you know, like Louis Satterfield was like street savvy, Chicago, Southside dude. They lived in Bronzeville. And he had the knack for just kind of like getting stuff done. And next you know, they become like rhythm sections for, you know, small little bands around Chicago and so on and so forth. And from there, that's when he really got the taste to really want to be to the point that he realized that he was trying to do both the music and work. And the job was great because they let him keep the job even though he had gigs around town. Those times where he'd be rushing from the L train to get from one place to the other with this full drum kit that he has to carry, just all that kind of thing. But finally he realized that after getting so many gigs that he was really good, he ended up letting the hospital go and focus on drumming full time. And, you know, it was rough. He talked about in his book, you know, how he was eating one meal a day. You know, he would go down to a place that would sell like pizzas and hummus. About not asking his parents, because the thing about it was his parents didn't first really go into like, you can do it, we have confidence in you. It was like, he'd go on, he'd be back in 5 months, you know, that kind of thing. And he was adamant about proving them wrong. So he didn't want to go back to asking, because you know, at that time, the parents of that generation was all about get a job, and pay his bills, especially with his life. To push you to go pursue a career that still yet at that point in time wasn't a big money maker for blacks. So, but nevertheless, he stuck it out and ended up in the office of Chess Records, The mighty Chess Records, 21st in Michigan. And at this point, of course, Chess Records had been like the king with Muddy Waters and Buddy Guy, and basically Chicago Blues, Etta James. But it's in this period, we're talking the 60s, where they now passed their hits and now trying to get into the next phase or whatever. And this next phase coming to music, Motown was king. So now it's trying to get these new rhythms and new things going. And Maurice was impressed with them, so they became session players at Chess. This was a band he was in Chicago called the Jazz Band. And that's him. Ooh, he looks so young. They actually entered a competition at the Jazz Band and won the competition. The judges, esteemed panel and stuff. And actually, that was his first time meeting Quincy Jones. And they ended up being, of course, really good friends later on. But yeah, so all these members of the Jazz Band eventually led to them working at the studios, you know, players at Chess. And they played on some major hits, but one of the first records that did really well for them, I'm gonna play right now. Y'all know that song? Y'all heard it before?
Yeah.
So yeah, that was Maurice White on drums on that song. And the first thing they noticed that there with him is that his ability to play R&B after being a jazz drummer and his versatility. And so that song right there ended up being a moderate hit for Betty Everett. Of course, that next song was the Shoot Shoot song. You know, Is It In His Hands? Is It His Kiss? But that song led to Maurice White getting more work in demand in the industry because this song did really well, especially in this region. And from there, he started playing on several other things, mainly, Billy Stewart. Yeah. GQ.
Yeah.
So, sidebar information on GQ. Did y'all also know that Keith Sweat was a member of GQ?
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, so those classic songs, that's actually Maurice White on the drums. And here's another classic song. This is actually the session where he actually worked with a singer by the name of Minnie Riperton. And she was on background vocals on this song. And it was a huge hit for Chess.
I'm not afraid to die.
Okay. Yeah, so that was actually Maurice White, Bruce Satterfield, okay, and the Gems, which included Lenny Ripperton on vocal. That's a lot of power in one room. Only at that time in 1966, I don't think they realized how much power was in that room. And also in 1966, he worked with an artist by the name of Herb Lanz. Herb Lanz was a very big singer in the 40s. And this album was actually a comeback album. This is why it's called The Comeback, where he actually recreated some of his bigger hits from the 40s and 50s with Maurice White and Louis Satterfield on drums. And his version of Close Your Eyes was very, very, pretty popular. So I want to play that one as well. Step for Maurice as well, because this was the first time that he actually worked with a producer who was actually on this album, Keith, by the name of Charles Stepney.
Hey.
Charles Stepney and Cleveland Eaton. This was his first time working with them, and there will be a pivotal point, because after this, he, Ramsey Lewis, his first two and Maurice filled in on a couple of gigs while they were looking for replacements for his trio. And Ramsey at some point asked Maurice to officially join the trio, which means that he had to leave working full-time at Chess. Because at this time, Ramsey Lewis in the jazz world and in the pop world was a superstar. So, but because Maurice had been working so much TV jingles for commercials hired by Richard Marx's father. And so because he had all these streams of income already, he knew he didn't negotiate, because he was like, I didn't need the money because I had insurance. So when he negotiated with Ramsey, it wasn't even negotiation, he came with a high price, like he hit him with a high number, and he said, Ramsey was like, okay. And he was kind of shocked at his confidence in himself at that moment to ask for this amount of money, got him what he wanted. And nevertheless, he ended up officially becoming a member of the Ramsey Lewis Trio. And this is one of the things that changed his life dramatically, because it took him out of being a session player in Chicago to traveling the globe. So this was his first time going to other countries, because again, Ramsey Lewis was a superstar. Fusing pop and jazz into where the pop world, the crossover world, really accepted. And so this was an eye-opener for him, because it was also a change, because Ramsey was all about being dressed proper, pristine, you know, just this whole thing. And so basically Ramsey was one of his first big mentors and teachers in this industry and how to perform, stage lighting, and one of the first big songs that he did with Ramsey Lewis was Ramsey Lewis' version of Wade in the Water. are. And for this, at this point, this was 1967, and he was with Ramsey Band for a few years, and then ran at some point after just an extended amount of touring from country to country and everything else, getting back, Ramsey actually fell ill and decided to take a break to get himself back together. And so in the meantime, Maurice didn't want to sit still and wait on Ramsey to continue working and everything. So he just kind of continued, you know, still doing jingles and still doing things. And he reconnected with his buddy Louis Satterfield. And at this point, we're talking 1968, 69, and things are changing social, politically, majorly. We're talking after the assassination of Martin Luther King, after Malcolm X and all this other thing, and all these new, like, black movements really surfacing. And another pivotal part for him this moment, this time, was at this point he started hanging out on 39th and Drexel at the Afro Arts Theater. This is also the place where he met a young Yvette Stevens, where a Nigerian, a Yoruba priest gave her the name Shaka. So imagine this is the place where Maurice White, Shaka Khan, Whitney Brooks, you know, Amiri Baraka, this was the hangout for them on 39th and Drexel. And it was here that Louis Satterfield and the sort of the jazz band that became a group called the Pharaohs. You know about that, huh?
My dad was a part of it.
Oh, yay. Yay, I love to hear that. so this was the hub. And contrary to rumor, the Afro Arts Theater was not a place for black thugs to hang out. You know what I'm saying? But of course, anything associated with black consciousness at this point is trying to be a place, a source for black people to feel uplifted in their blackness and to embrace their African culture. And it best perceived as some sort of threat, cult, whatever. You know what I mean? But nevertheless, this really was a place where he first got in tune with his Africanness. And with the Pharaohs, they actually Chicago stuff, right? Yeah. So, going back to Afro Arts Theater, one of the founders was the great Phil Caron. Holmes just passed away this last year, and Phil was the one. Phil raised a lot of children. And what I mean by that is just literally and figuratively. He has so many in our community. The AACM would not exist without Phil Caron. But it was Phil Caron was also the inventor of what was called the Frankie Phone, which was basically an African funk piano that he electrified. This instrument. That's the inventor, Phil Caron, right there with the Frankie Phone. And that is where that changed, obviously, because we all know that the calypso became his signature thing. So it was Phil Caron invention, he was the one that introduced it to him. So after that, when he went back on the road with Ramsey Lewis, he's now incorporated that into his show. Well, Ramsey actually forced him to incorporate it into the show. Because again, Maurice was a very shy dude. He didn't really want to come behind the drum set. The drum was actually perfect for him because he could sit in the back and maybe do a solo but not have to be frontwards. But Ramsey Lewis was the one that encouraged him to come in the forefront with the kalimba, to the point that when he would do his solos, he had a separate mic for him to stand on the stage in the spotlight to solo. Separated track and everything. That's amazing to me right now. Producers get that. So yeah, that was his first recording playing the kalimba. It was with Ramsey Lewis. It's on this album called Another Voyage. The name of the song is Uhuru. And this was actually will be the last album they recorded with Ramsey, because after this, he had a premonition, if you will, and an idea to start his own thing. And so this was his final album. But one of the last things he did do with the Ramsey Lewis Trio was Charles Stepney had commissioned them to play, be the band for Me and Rick Hudson's Baby. White on the drums along with that. Thank you. that you album do not sleep. Because in my opinion, it's the absolute best work.
Yeah.
Charles Stepney is such an underrated, unappreciated. People like who call him the Burt Bacharach. I would say Burt Bacharach is the white Charles Stepney. So anyway, there's another song on this album that I want to play because I just thought Maurice drumming on it was so damn, man. Because I've actually played this album many nights where I've had it on repeat. So if you've never heard this album, I suggest y'all get this album. So anyway, starting his journey on solo, the fact that he's just left a huge salary with Ramsey Lewis, huge salary at the time, to go solo, he connected with a brother by the name of Don Whitehead, and a singer by the name of Wade Flemings. Wade was actually a solo artist actually in the 50s, and he was ended up being most known for writing the song Stay in My Corner for the Dells. So they formed a group called the Salty Peppers and ended up securing a contract with Capitol Records. And I'm gonna play this song, La La Time. Baseline. because that's Donny Hathaway on this song. So the earliest version of what will become Earth, Wind & Fire did include Donny Hathaway. Yeah. Was never still able to generate anything. And so with their connection with Capitol, Maurice felt it was now time to leave Chicago. And they moved to LA and added a couple more members with a singer named Sherry Scott and moved to LA to, you know, try to pursue work. And I got to, only to get to LA and Maurice now being told that Capitol was not interested in signing them as a full artist. They gave him a singles deal, but they never gave him an album deal. Wow. So he's not letting on to the band just because he don't want to, you know, kill their spirit and morale and everything. So he went about the work of trying to secure another deal, and that led him to being into the home of his first manager, Jim Brown. When he first moved up in Jim Brown's house, Jim Brown answered the door and just sat there chilling naked. He wrote in the book that, like, I guess he was so used to being in the locker room with other men that he literally was there. They lay like, oh, yo, home. But nevertheless, Jim took them on his management team, and he actually secured them a deal with Warner Brothers. To a famed astrologer to do his astrology chart, because at this point Maurice is, like, again, he, you know, through the Afro Arts Theater, he starts studying Egyptology, he started really getting into metaphysics and things of that nature, and doing his astrology, doing his chart, they discovered that there was no water on his chart. It was on earth, air, and fire. And change the name of the group to Earth, Wind, and Fire. So that is the first promo picture, actually, of Earth, Wind, and Fire. They were killing it, weren't they? I love that one, too. At this point, too, I have to mention that he had pulled his brother, Verdine, into the group. Verdine was only 19 years old. Which he had never been anywhere. He was only 19. Wow. So this was a big deal for Verdine coming into, because he was also the one that brought Verdine his first bass, and Louis Spatterfield ended up being Verdine's teacher. Yeah. And so, yeah, I love these photos. They kill me. So with this, they got their first album on one of our brothers. Self-titled, and then I'll play a song from that. Yeah. in this group that he wanted to be a group that focused on uplifting songs, uplifting people, uplifting spirit and the conscious, all that, which was a hard sell for a lot of people at that time. Oh yeah. So the first album came out, killer stuff on that. Warner Brothers. So they moved on to the next album.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna feature this song because this is one of the songs that stood out for most because it actually features Siri Scott on vocals. In this time period, they also ended up connecting with another Chicagoan, Melvin Van Peebles.
Yeah.
And they provided the music for that Suits Ass Badass song on the soundtrack. Which I'm not going to play. It's very cinematic soundtracking. You get it. But moving on, so with no luck at Warner Brothers, even though they're still signed, Maurice is already like, this ain't working. They're not getting the vision and this and the other. In addition to it, not only are the record execs not getting division, the actual musicians are now, they're not getting division either. And they're kind of exhausted trying to become something. And so what he didn't know is that the band had been having meetings without him. And at some point approached him basically to dethrone him. Yeah. Your leadership isn't working, this and the other, so on and so forth, and it ended up being in this match where and that he actually owned, because the one thing about being at Chess and being under all these great people was he learned the business early. So he actually had owned the name of Friend of Fire. So I didn't want to know it. You know, while y'all was playing and doing this and the other, because you know, I was actually doing about the business of trademarking and all that. So, yeah. So needless to say, all the band left except Bernie. So now he's panicked because on the label, they had gigs lined up. He has to get new players and he has to do all this without the label knowing that there's, you know, that things are not right at home. So he eventually went about the business of recruiting new players, and he just got to work. And the first people that came to mind was these two cats that he saw while they performed in Denver and opened up for them in another band. And so one by one, he auditioned them. Larry, the one on the end, he thought was the key. He was like, to the point, he was like, can I need to see your ID? Because he was so okay with and everything else. Guitarist Roy Batista was another one that came into that. He auditioned and came into the group. And a young sax player by the name of Ronnie Laws.
Yeah.
Which some actually people. And from there too, they also added had another female singer by the name of Helena Dixon, and everything got ready to go. And now the thing was I need to get away from Warner Brothers. And he actually didn't think Jim Brown was going to do it. And he decided to part ways with Jim as a manager. And Jim understood, actually, and still pulled somebody from his management team to still work for Urban Five, who continued to work for them pretty much like the whole career. So they went and hired his manager by the name of Bob Cavallo. And Bob would be the trick to get them going. Bob actually secured a secret audition for them to audition for Clive Davis, who at the time was running CBS Records. So they secretly auditioned for him at this apartment. They was actually on the balcony. And Clive Davis was actually blown. And he got out, and he got an holiday contract without Warner Brothers knowing they had already got a yes from CBS. Smart, right? So they get ready now to record the new record. The singer, Helena Dixon, left. And so then he added a singer by the name of Jessica Cleese. Y'all remember the group The Friends of Distinction?
Yeah.
That was Jessica Cleese from The Friends of Distinction. Which Jim Brown was also The Friends of Distinction. Dating her. He just got all these people there. You know, but nevertheless, they got together, and this is now the new unit. And I'm gonna play this video. This is one of their first televised performances. Y'all remember a TV show called Soul?
Sisters, very pleasant to meet you too.
I'm actually going to go ahead and skip. You got to see the intro. I'm going to skip to the next video. So this. Songs that you saw this far was from their debut album called Last Days of Time. And of course he was thinking about the political climate, everything was on at the moment. The cover, he was always wanting to reflect things in their cover art. And so the guy who did the covers, the album covers for Santana and for Business Group from Miles Davis, was also free of this alpha here. I'm gonna keep moving though to this one. One of their classic photos. And this one was to me, well, one is the symbolism as far as this record and these covers was that he was adamant about people seeing people of color and men of color at peace. And because he was also into yoga and meditation, the lotus position was a very huge deal that people didn't understand. And so when they actually one of their first shows they did together, he told them at the last minute, everybody get on the floor in the lotus position. To themselves. And the crowd didn't get what was going on to the point they started booing them. And then one by one they got up to their instruments and then they killed it. Of course, by the end the crowd loved it. But they didn't get the symbolism of them in this position. So Maurice was really like changing people's thoughts and ideas and consciousness around meditation, around yoga, around Egyptology, around the African-centered things that no one was doing at the time in the mainstream. And from this album, I want to feature this song called Evil. Thank you. So that song was very significant because it solidified that Maurice would have to come behind the drums and actually be one of the lead singers of the group, because he wasn't really trying to be in the front. That's why he kept hiding. Not like top 10, but did pretty well, and that actually was the thing that led him to be more of a vocal as opposed to just the drummer and the arranger for the group. And then this next song. So the first step that afforded them a bigger budget to do some stuff. So Maurice White in August told Charles Stephanie when he made enough money that he's gonna come back and get it. So for the next record, we went to Chicago and got his boy. Because again, this is Charles Stephanie was such a genius arranger and producer. Again, this is the man that actually brought out Minnie Riperton's whistle register, and it was the one that influenced her to incorporate this into her music, making her the first singer in R&B to incorporate the whistle register. This was all because of this man. And I pulled this picture because that's him and his family, his daughters. I was hoping his daughter, Shantae Stephanie, was supposed to be here, but I don't see her. So we're gonna keep it moving. So the next album, he talked to them before then, they were borrowing rhythms and rituals and stuff, and he really sat down and showed them step by step how to make things work. But again, he was about orchestration, he was about all this stuff. So for the album with him, the title track, Maurice White felt compelled to do because he fell in love with the original gospel song, Open Up Our Eyes, thanks to Hurricane. And y'all all knew, played that song at the end of the show.
Yeah.
Or the beginning of the show, every show. And Maurice White fell in love with that, and he ended up recording this version of it. Staple from this album. I'm gonna play the live version though. And I think y'all might know that song. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
That's a song. It's okay. It's fine. So that song, of course, ends up being a staple to this day. And this album. While doing this, now I went back with Charles Stephanie, Ramsey Lewis was like, hey, I want in. I heard y'all got the band back together. So, you know, can I get a little of this? So they went back, it's about 1974, and they started working with Ramsey again, and came up with this number here.
Yeah. Maurice White is a shining star in the music. Yes, that's the wave of the world coming this summer to coincide with Earth, Wind, and Fire summer tour.
So how many of y'all knew that was a movie?
Yeah.
So that movie, they got propositioned to do this movie. In the movie, Harvey Keitel plays a man that's producing a band. But it was all about the ills of the record industry, so drugs, payola, and this and the other. Well, after they saw the movie, Maurice, he knew that it was going to be a flop. That's now better go on DVD if you guys want to go check it out. But knowing that it was going to be, he actually convinced the label to allow him to put out the soundtrack for it ahead of the release of the movie. Because if you put it out afterwards, they may not. Yeah. So put that out ahead of the release of the movie, which is the reason why probably a lot of people didn't know it was actually a soundtrack, because it came out before the movie came out. And rightfully so, because the official album came out. And this was their first big crossover album. Shining Star ended up being the number one song, pop and R&B. And this was the thing that took them to the next phase. So now officially, 1975, Earth, Wind, and Fire has officially arrived as a global phenomenon. And so like I said, it was fueled by Shining Star as a single, which as you heard in the thing, but I have to, of course, play this song. So what they did was they put out this album called Gratitude, which majority of it was actually a live concert. So that version that you hear, Reasons, Lies, and Devotion, that all came from this album. But there were a few studio tracks on this album. There's one in particular I want to play, is when they first started working with a writer and arranger, a producer by the name of Skip Scarborough.
Oh, yeah.
Skip, actually, I could do another reading session on him, too, because he's been one of the most prolific songwriters that's responsible for a lot of songs that probably birthed you people. A group by the name of Creative Source recorded this song. Y'all know this song?
Oh, this one. Oh, yeah.
Skip Scarborough. So bringing that up now, get into the machine of Brooklyn and Fire. So with all of this success, Charles Stephanie and Maurice White is now forming Calimba Productions and begin to now going to begin to spread their production to other artists and create a network. And one of the first artists they started working for, again, the first thing I always think about is home, was the Hutchinson Sisters. And so that's actually all four of the sisters there. That's Donna, Sheila, Jeanette, and Pam. And so the first single from the first album they did is this one. things of that nature. You know, Minnie Richardson was also one of the people on the background singer before one of those. And so Stevie was not so excited because he wanted to produce the beats, but he didn't say he was into them. So she came to this opportunity. And this will end up being the last album with Charles Stepney's production. Actually, he had already passed by the time it came out. And so in honor of him, this song here, the title track, was actually dedicated. It was actually, they were writing it while he was still alive to lift his spirits because he had been sick. And ended up turning into a whole other animal after he passed away. Martial arts and all these other things, and then pyramids, and of course everything associated with each of his feet. That's how they went over there and stole everything. You know, but again, for me as a kid, these images were powerful because I had never seen this before. You know what I mean? So, yeah, just groundbreaking. So with this, they go on continue. They go on tour. Ramsey Lewis, The Emotions, the tour, amazing tour. They have all the staging and everything. They actually hired the choreographer, George Faison. Hitting the magician. So now they do magic tricks the whole nine. They eventually end up with David Copperfield. So all of that was just.
Kiss bit off of them with the man.
Oh, yeah. That's a picture of Brandon White. He was literally levitating in the air for minutes. Up going with Tom Washington, who's still living, and continue on with the brand. So they, Denise's next album, which really didn't sell much. But this album changed. This is actually my favorite album by them.
Yeah.
But then who we are to
yeah.
So this and went over to there and they invited him in, him really, really getting into the culture. So he had been a fan of his music actor. And everything, but going over to actual Brazil and seeing the black people of Brazil and feeling that rhythm really, really changed something within them. And so that the energy from this album came from that. And with that being said, one of the first songs that they did for this, people confused by the vocals and they didn't understand what was going on. Well, not confused, but again,
I'm not afraid to die.
to look up a group by the name of Danta Black Rio. They're a Brazilian group, and they are like the Brazilian Earth, Wind, and Fire. And yeah, that. I'm gonna keep it.
Danta Black Rio.
So while we're here, as with the last two, I'm actually going to create playlist from this. And add a few things for y'all to check out. So I will post that, and I will send y'all the link to be able to go to the playlist. Will that help everybody out?
Yeah.
Because obviously with Maurice White Earth, Wind & Fire, I can't cover every song and everything. So yeah, I'll be posting a link for the playlist on tomorrow, hopefully. So that album ended up being the actual biggest selling R&B album of 1977. Actually, the Spirit album was the second biggest of 1976, which of course, sold the key of life was number one.
Yeah!
And with that, he actually had the fuel now with all the hit records. He had the fuel now. I don't feel American recording company. And so everything after that, every Amplified album and Denise Wiggs album after that, came under Maurice White's own label, and now this whole machine is built. So the next album, of course, I Am What I Feel About This Body, was a huge thing. And this album was actually difficult too, because this is the first time working with a young songwriter producer by the name of David Foster. Now, because this song was actually significant. But that song actually was very, very influential, and this is what I want to get into about the Earth, Wind & Fire machine, because they became a machine where they knew that it sounded the same vein, that this song was actually derived from Best of My Love. Inspired by, and they took in the riff from Best of My Love. And that was because David Foster also wrote that song. So, yeah. And this next song, actually Skip Scarborough was talking about a woman who would eventually become his wife by the name of Alton McLean. He had a group called Alton McLean and Destiny. This was another song that Best of My Love supplied. We'll be right back. quote unquote older head to another song. Actually, my older sister and her friends actually performed that in a talent show in 1979, so that's how I remember it and everything. But yeah, that was another song that was spawned from Best of My Love. Actually, this is just a promo. If you guys are looking for Skip, because they have a songbook CD on Skip Sarbaro with some of his best works. And there's another CD called The Spirit of Earth, Wind, and Fire with a lot of the stuff from the Machine promo CD. So I encourage y'all to look those up and get them. The Pockets. This was actually another group that was actually on. Yeah, the sound of Urban Fire, right? Woo! Y'all know this song, of course, then.
Yes.
Right here. Yeah, that was a Chicago Quiet Storm classic. Another group I like is a group called Splendor. What's up, look it up. None of them are out, but the song has been long drawn out. But Splendor is another group. And another group that came by a different scene was a group called Kinsman Bass. Kinsman Bass is a group out of Ohio. And they had two albums. Amazingly, on the first album, they had Patrice Rushton on like Michael Jackson played on this album. Played keys on this album. Michael Jackson played keys on this album. There's a group called Kids and Dads. Just so they know, he can tell how much he was early in the part of the scene, just right now. This is a group called Afterbot. Now, this group was the actual group that was on Maurice White's label. That was actually, the Boogie Wonderland was actually written for them. And Earth and the Fire, even though they're this high machine, they had started overspending in their shows because they had David Copperfield. They had Rodgers on the label, they had a singer named Larry Carter, all these artists on the label, nothing on the label was sustaining the label outside of Denise Williams. Denise Williams album, of course, when Love Comes Calling, and of course, the very popular one was. And fire as nucleus of the 90s. Started streamline bands, and this is really electrical, you know, drum machines and stuff coming and came into play. And of course, you know, in the mid to late 80s, a lot of bands had disbanded, and the vocalists would go solo in the late 80s. So it was a very struggle for bands to survive in this market. So with their next album, they had to go with, of course, you know, this song. They actually didn't like that song. Because at this point, it's them now instead of them being Urban and Fire, who was creating hits and inspired people. Now they're chasing hits and trying to incorporate whatever sound is out there in the industry. And it just wasn't them. And so for them, this is when the band really started to kind of crumble. Al McKay, who was a very important part of the band, left the group. And at this point, that's when they started dismantling. They actually ended up disbanding after the Howlett album, which was this album. But Maurice White. We attacked to produce another upcoming artist that Bob began to manage at the time. He was actually initially. That would have been nice to get a one. Maurice White with his Prince record. But there was another person that's coming up at this point who had actually just won a Grammy from singing on Broadway. And as came time to work on her first David album, Maurice White ended up being the producer for it. And that was Jennifer Holliday. So, y'all know that emotion singing back around, right? So, a lot of people was like, oh,
sweet shit around the neck.
And of course, this song was, has that after the love is gone kind of vibe. Nothing from that brought them back to the forefront, which is all good because at some point it's like you get to this peak, you know what I mean? And you, their legacy has transcended decades. So many artists of today to this day, so many people have sampled their work, you know, things of that nature. And so for me, generation, just that whole, the imagery, just the whole box of consciousness and all this other stuff, none of this stuff existed before. So that's kind of where I want to leave it with Maurice White. You know, just his influence, just so many things that came out of the machine, just his business savvy, the way he was able to get in there, negotiate contracts, trademark, and just do all this stuff, because you know, there's a lot of bands who didn't make it because of faulty business practices. And that was the one thing that didn't happen in that. You know what I mean? Which was a rarity because so many of us, you know, we had the rock star dreams and everything else and not realizing the price that goes along with it. Or to this day, we have people in the industry who get in the industry, do one thing, and never learn the business side of their industry, end up taking advantage of, end up, you know, being owed and royalties and being up on this and the other. And for him to come in the game knowing so much about business because he followed his mentors was huge. And a huge thing for a black man from the second migration of the migration, you know, the second wave of migration into Chicago, Bronzeville. So I'm gonna leave it there because we have run out of time, but that was pretty much all the energy. Of course, you know, the superhero. I love that photo. His name is Brandon Markell Holmes. He's incredible. He's going to come up here. In the meantime, while we change the set over, Cheryl Reese is going to hand out some surveys. You guys, please can fill out these surveys so we can, you know, find out what kind of job we're doing, figure out where we can be better, so on and so forth. And while we also change over, if they don't fill out, was there anybody who actually had a question? No, it wasn't.
Green on the piano. And the guitar, sorry. I'm playing a show at City Winery on Monday. If you're interested in tickets, I got some flyers over here if you are interested. Thank you so much, Duane, for having me. Thank you, Arts Incubator of Chicago. Thank you, Cheryl Reese. Thank you, all of you, for being here.
Get ready to clear out this room. I want to thank all of y'all, the ones that's been to every one of these. I want to thank everybody who just came for the first time. I hope you had a good time. I hope, you know, this was either, you know, it could have either been merely a celebration of Maurice White for you, or you could have actually learned something. On behalf of everybody here, our incubator, Brain Trust Manager, Michelle Reese, and myself, we want to thank y'all for being here. And definitely check out all the other programming that they have here, because they have a lot of amazing things going on. But with that said, we got to clear out the room, so let's get ready to head out. Again, thank y'all, and we will see y'all in the next season that we put together, okay? Now, all my friends know that I'm going to do a group photo, so get up.